Hey guys, this is Vikas again with another episode on Run With Fitpage. Today, again, we have someone very, very special, and you will be more excited to hear of this conversation than I am speaking about it. We have Hugh Brasher, the director of London Marathon, with us today. In the conversation today, you will not only understand about London Marathon, but you will also know about this inspirational journey that Hugh has taken from the early childhood, how he formed Sweatshop, which became the largest sporting retail shop, which was later acquired. And also you would see that how he grew in a family of champions. His mother, who was a French Open tennis champion, his father was an Olympic gold medalist in 1956, and also a pacer to Sir Roger Bannister. You would be amazed to see the kind of humbleness and the kind of go-getter approach that Hugh carries with him. In the conversation today, you will also learn about small tips and tricks that will help you to be a better runner if you're just getting started. I don't want to bore you with my conversation any further, and I want you to join me in welcoming Hugh Brasher to the show.
Hugh, welcome to Run With Fitpage. It's a great pleasure to have you.
Thank you very much. It's lovely to be here.
We will get to London Marathon in a bit, but I'm amazed with your family's background and your background, where it all started, specifically your mother. She being the French Tennis Open champion in all three categories, and then also your dad, he being the gold medalist at the Olympics, and also being the pacer for Sir Roger Bannister. How did it feel as you were growing up to be in the champions family?
It felt very normal because I didn't know anything else. So I think it's one of those things where people put sports people or celebrities on a pedestal. And there's no need to do that. They're just normal people. This was just my dad and my mum. And, you know, people, particularly with my dad, might come up to him at an airport or speak to him. And it's just like, I don't know, it was just an everyday occurrence. And I didn't think that much of it. It's more when you get older in life, I think that you realize the incredible nature of each of their lives, and then the fact that they were married for so long, to have two sports people of that magnitude. As you say, my mother won, both the mixed, the doubles and the singles at Roland Garros at the French Open. And then my father with the Olympic gold medal pacing Sir Roger Bannister, but then co-founding the London Marathon. And that co-founding of the London Marathon is probably in all reality what he's most remembered for. They're just your parents, your mum and your dad. And I was brought up with sport in our family. Everyone played tennis. My sister became a professional tennis player. I played sort of decent standard tennis, as did my younger sister. So all our holidays were just at Eastbourne, which is a small seaside town where the national tennis championships were held. And that's what we did as kids. And whether it was tennis, and I'd do a bit of skiing. And I actually didn't start running until I was 18. It was just that, we sort of did my mother's sport rather than my father's.
Right. In the hindsight, when I look at it, it just seems like everything came together very beautifully. Everything worked like clockwork. But I'm sure there is a lot of rigor, diligence, hard work, leadership, everything that's been put forth in the last 4 or 5 decades when we look at it. For example, as you grew, then you started Sweatshop. Before formally being associated with London Marathon. So everything around sport and endurance sport, and that's amazing. But how did you go about building Sweatshop? How did that happen? When you learned running, did you then grow fascination for endurance sport and you saw the market was growing, or how was that?
Yeah, I think, I mean, just for your listeners, is Sweatshop was the UK's largest specialist running chain. So, yeah. So we started with one shop and I sold the business. And when I sold it, it had 43 shops around the UK. And it also was the organizer of two of the biggest half marathons in the country. So it organized the Reading Half Marathon, which had about 17,500 participants, which I think made it the second largest half marathon in the UK. And it also organized the Experian Robin Hood Marathon and Half Marathon, which again had in total about 15,000 people. It had an internet arm. I mean, that came about really because I understood customer services. And, you know, I was in sport and I would work at Sweatshop from the age of 15 in my school holidays. And I would then go and take that. It was a specialist running shop, but at that stage, it also sold tennis rackets and various other things. I was a tennis player. I would sell tennis rackets at school. I'd take the rackets in and start telling people, you know, giving them the advice on what was the best racket. So I think I just understood what consumers wanted, and what that was great advice, honestly given, right. And not trying to sell someone the most expensive thing, but actually trying to advise them on what would help them be the best that they could be. And I think that this is what very much my family taught me, is there are things you can control and there are things that you can't control. Yeah. And you can control whether you are the best you can be. What you can't control is whether someone else is better than that.
True.
So I always use Michael Johnson and Roger Black as that example. Michael Johnson broke the world 400 meter record. And this was, I think, Atlanta 1996. And he was so far ahead of everybody else. Roger Black, who was the British record holder, who was a great athlete, his gold medal was coming second because Michael Johnson was going to win and his gold medal was coming second. What he could control was how good he could be, how fast he could be. He couldn't control how good Michael Johnson could be. And I think in life, that is a great lesson. So Sweatshop was founded on, you know, people have very busy lives. They have a limited amount of time they can put into running, but they would often want to be the best they could be as a runner. And so I understood that. Our staff were trained in biomechanics. We put some pretty high tech equipment into the shop. So it was the first ever retail outlet where you had a physiology lab within the shop. So we would take blood from your earlobe and measure the amount of oxygen in your blood as you exercised at different speeds to be able to advise you on the best training to enable you to train for the least possible time and get the best outcome. And that was 1997. So that was 24 years ago. So that was pretty sort of out there. You know, built up those shops, took over two of these road races. The Experian Robin Hood Marathon and Half Marathon was in 2001. We took that over from Nottingham Council, and we had 19 weeks to organize the event. And at that stage, something in the UK called foot and mouth disease happened. And that had huge consequences for races and especially ours. And then, in terms of, we've just had the 20 year anniversary of the terrible tragedy of 9/11, and the event was 2 weeks after that. So it was a very difficult time to organize such an event, but we did and got through that. And then 2 years later took over the Reading Half Marathon. And then from that, I became joint race director in 2010 of the London Marathon. But yeah, it was never part of a plan. It sort of happened.
It's all came together.
It's in my blood.
Awesome. I think when you talk about 1997, and that's the kind of technology you were using, looking at the gait, the biomechanics, taking blood from the earlobes. We are at that stage in India now where the shops are starting to become specialized shops. And now the consumers are aware that they don't want to buy the most expensive shoes, but rather they want to see what's going to be right shoe for them. And people are getting more and more curious. They go for an experience and relevance both when they go to a store. And I get super excited when I see this, and we are trying to do our bit to reduce misinformation. I'm thinking when you were doing it, it's not easy because possibly you didn't have a precedence of that happening. Here we have a precedence of it being happened already in developed countries. So how did you go about imagining that? How did you go about planning for something like that and allowing runners to get that kind of experience and that competitive edge?
I think a few different things. I think one is being curious. Right. So being curious about the world and getting information in from a lot of different people. And, you know, my father was not the most talented runner. If you go of the triumvirate that were at the, you know, my father was the first pacemaker, Chris Chataway was the second, and Sir Roger Bannister broke the 4-minute mile. Both Chris and Roger were world record holders. When my father won his Olympic gold medal, he was only the third best Briton in the field. But he was all for experimentation. And he had a very curious mind. And I think in terms of I ran, and I just sort of looked at, well, I was working 70 hours a week. I was running 70 miles a week. And how could I get the best out of myself in those circumstances? And just thinking, if you put yourself into other people's shoes, what yeah. experience would they want? And how can you simplify it? Because people don't need to know the ins and outs of the technical requirement of a running shoe or of a heart rate monitor or the latest app. They just want it to work. They want it to be simple, and they want the outcome to be what they asked for. And if you can simplify that explanation, if you can succinctly explain, listen to what they want, then you will be able to deliver that. And do not assume what someone wants is the same. You've got to listen to what the person is saying and then help them. And I think it's just, yeah, it's just that was part of my DNA of wanting to help people and being curious.
Yeah, awesome. Preempting, listening, and executing on what you heard is awesome with the way you describe it. Just makes so much sense. Before we move ahead, out of curiosity, is this your dad's singlet behind the jersey 226 that he won the gold medal in 1956?
Yes, it is. Very, very well spotted. That is exactly his jersey. That's the picture of him crossing the finish line.
If awesome.
You, if I just show you there, that is yeah. the picture of the vest that he wore when he was the pacemaker for Sir Roger Bannister. So, yeah, it's a lovely piece of memorabilia. I'm in my office at London Marathon. And, yeah, I found these vests after he died in 2003. They were in the cellar of my parents' house, and they now adorn the wall behind.
Awesome. Beautiful. That is so inspirational to even look at. Moving forward about London Marathon, I'm sure you saw it all coming together, but how did the story of London Marathon came together in itself? I've heard through the grapevines the pub story, but I want for you to describe well, because you do describe really, really well.
Yeah, as I say, I mean, lots of great conversations start in a pub. That's such a British thing. It's like our culture is, you know, with COVID, which has been such a terrible thing for society around the world, And a huge thing in terms of for Britain was the day the pubs reopened, because culturally that's where we have so many conversations. And he used to, his running club, which was called Ranelagh Harriers, their clubhouse is behind a pub near our house where I grew up. And in 1979, various club members had been to the, various club members had been to the New York Marathon, had run the New York Marathon. And they came back to the pub and they were telling my dad these stories of this most incredible race. And my father loved the outdoors. He loves the countryside. The thought for him of running 26.2 miles on the road, he actually couldn't think of anything worse. But they kept on and on about the joy, the crowd, the emotion, the feeling that they got from the support and the togetherness. And however they did it, he was persuaded to go out to New York in 1979. And he went out with John Disley, who, you know, John and he did so many things together. John was bronze medalist in the 1952 Olympics, and he was actually the British favorite for when my father won his gold medal. But they went to New York, and my father wrote an article in the Observer in October 1979, and he described very emotively how he had heard the roar of the crowd when he won his Olympic gold medal. He had been there in 1966, where Britain had won the World Cup, when he'd been there when Gordon Richards had won the Derby. But he said he'd never, ever heard such a roar of New York City coming together and supporting the then 20,000 people, everyday people, on this incredible journey of running 26.2 miles through the five boroughs of New York, this great city, but this great city that at that time was the gun crime capital city of the world. Hard to believe now, but that's what it was. And he, his final sentence was, he knew London had the course, but did it have the heart, and did it have the soul to welcome the world? And that, I believe the answer is yes, we do. And now, sorry, that's my lights going off in the background. Now, more than ever, I think that in a world that has been torn apart by COVID, by the fact that we can't be together and loved ones and families are split, marathon running and the community spirit that we bring together is needed more than ever. And we are welcoming some of the world to the Virgin Money London Marathon on the 3rd of October, 2021. One of the reasons we've moved, you know, it's now the TCS in 2022. Our partnership with TCS has been announced. I mean, one of the great, great Indian companies. I mean, why move it to October? Because we truly want to welcome the whole world to this community spirit, the fundraising, the stories that come out of the everyday person. Those are the stories that resonate and inspire the world to get fit, to get healthy, to improve their mental and physical fitness. And that, more than ever, is what's so important.
So true. I've been running for 22 years, but every time I speak to someone like you, I get goosebumps, because I truly believe as well that running just starts with one small objective in the start, but it goes along with building stories, and then at the end it becomes all a life story. So true, you said. And there is another beautiful thing about running marathons, is that more than the people who are running, the people who are cheering, mostly they are non-runners. They possibly don't even know about the marathon distance, but they're cheering so well, shouting your names, the badge numbers, whatever you have, is just outstanding. City that day grows on you, and the following day, the Medal Monday, is just outstanding. So very well put, like you said, and such a visionary he was, that he saw it through and he built it through to where it has reached, and to the point of TCS coming on board. We were so proud when we heard the announcement. Tata Group as whole also is something where all of us Indians, we look at it like a big family, like a set of guardians looking over everybody who starts working. And they've done so much for the community. And Mr. Chandra himself being a good marathon runner himself, I see him running at the track where I go as well. It's outstanding. So we both are in Mumbai. So the track where he runs, I go on Wednesday, Tuesday, Wednesday, and I see him often. It's outstanding to see him and the entire team coming together to be part of it. Now, the first London Marathon, do you have memories of that? Because I was speaking with Dick Beardsley in one of the podcasts, and his storytelling ability is outstanding as well. And he narrated holding hands and reaching the finish line. Do you remember the first marathon, and do you want to talk through it as well?
Yeah, look, I think Dick is the most wonderful human being. And what is incredible, the relationship that he and Inga Simonsen now have. They were the joint winners of the London Marathon. And I think the story of that first year of Joyce Smith, who won the women's event, and a British woman to break the British record, to break the British record as well, is quite incredible. And they set the success of the London Marathon off in the way they performed and in their stories. And I was 16 at the time, and my father asked me to, could I sell the train tickets to the runners? Now your bib gets you a free train journey. Then you had to buy a train ticket. And I always remember that it was 50 pence, so half a pound, 50 pence. The registration, you picked your number up at the Strand Palace Hotel, which still exists down the Strand. And over the 3 days, I sold 6,300 train tickets. And I was 16, and it was in the Easter holiday, so I wasn't at school. And I'd been cycling to the train station, getting the train, working for 12 hours a day, getting the train back, cycling home, 16, that's quite exhausting for a 16-year-old. And all I remember was sleeping on the Sunday. And I didn't really know what had gone on. And I didn't really realize what had gone on until Monday. And on Monday, I woke up, and in our family, we always got two newspapers delivered. One was the Times and one was the Daily Mail. And I always remember on the front page of the Daily Mail was the picture of Dick Beardsley and Inga Simonsen crossing the line hand in hand. And that togetherness, that moment where they had battled each other for the 26 previous miles, but without a conversation, with something in their brains just going, we have experienced something truly amazing with this crowd. This is not about one of us beating the other. This is about us reaching out to my fellow runner and doing this hand in hand. And that was incredible, and I believe set the London Marathon up for the success. And what we like to say is we are the world's most human race. We bring people together, and that is what this year is all about, and our campaign, We Run Together.
Awesome. There couldn't have been anything better to summarize this. And you're so right. When I was also speaking with Dick, he said this was at the time when, like you said, no conversation at the finish line as they finished together. Both of them didn't understand each other's language either. But the message was the same, and it can only come from the message of sport. And you've seen that from the front, and you've seen it growing to it being the best race in the world. And you have built it, you have supported that, and now you've built it and you're leading from the front. How does it look like today?
Well, look, it's there is an incredible team here at London Marathon Events that are so passionate about inspiring people to go on the journey of running that 26.2 miles. And they try and get into so much detail and deliver an amazing experience. But I think the thing that is unbelievable, and you've mentioned it, is the crowd, that experience that you get, that feeling that you get of 750,000 people on the streets of London cheering you on a sea of positivity. And, you know, in life, we are lucky if we have four or five people that are really wanting us to be successful. On that day, you put your name on your t-shirt, your vest, whatever you're running in, and you will have tens of thousands of people cheering you every step of the way. And that, you know, we're not in sort of British sporting terms, we're not Harry Kane at Wembley, we're not Andy Murray at Wimbledon, but we will experience something that is the most life-affirming thing to experience. And that's why running the London Marathon and that support, it's why so many people want to do it. And that's what the team are passionate about delivering. And it's been, you know, on the 3rd of October this year, it will be 889 days since the last in-person London Marathon. So in 2020, we had a world record number of people running the virtual London Marathon, 37,966 people. We had the elite athletes running around St. James's Park. This year, we're hoping that there will be 40,000 people running from Greenwich to Westminster, 40,000 people virtually. It will actually be, even in the world that we're in, we will be uniting the world and we genuinely be getting people running together. And the team here are so passionate about making that happen. And again, with TCS, the partnership that we have as technology partner, I can't say some of the stuff that the app is going to do, but one of it, the team told me about it yesterday, and wow, is it exciting. And that, you know, technology can connect us in a way. You know, we're here we are, continents apart, yet we're talking as though we're not.
True.
Yes, it's not the same as actually meeting in person, but wow, I think that what we've learned in the last 18 months and what technology has helped with, and TCS have been such a part in helping us deliver the marathon, the London Marathon today. I mean, it's just, I'm so excited about what we're going to do in 22 and beyond. I'm excited about this year. The fact that the event is going ahead and all the protocols that the team have put in place so the event can safely happen, and the volunteers and what they're doing. So yeah, couldn't be more excited. And I'm just lucky, really lucky to be leading such an amazing team. And it is that team, it's those people who are so committed to making it a great experience and this event happening for the greater good of charities, of people's physical health, of their mental health, and hopefully showing the world that we are not defeated. We can still be together.
Indeed, and that will be the case. We cannot be defeated. We will continue to be together. I want your attention on last year's effort that your team had put together, specifically kids coming together in various schools. And I think anything that starts well, it has to start early. And you did that really, really well using technology and got various schools, hundreds of schools coming together. I think it's really important because a number of our listeners, as you know, the endurance sport athletes are mature athletes and they have kids. And so how did you do all of that to bring everybody to come and run the 2.6 miles, because that is going to also help our listeners to get influenced and impart positive information among their kids as well.
Yeah, look, I mean, kids are, they're the future. I mean, it's the most obvious statement. And looking after them and inspiring them and looking after them, again, in a world whereby their education has been really affected by COVID and in lockdown, not being able to go to school. In last year, we got 111,000 school kids to run the 2.6, the mini virtual London Marathon. And how do you do that? You do it through the brand of the London Marathon that has been built up over the last 40 years. And I think, again, if you just sort of reference my father and John Disley, what they did create is now one of the crown jewels of British sport. And you sort of say, what is Britain renowned for in sport? It is renowned for Wimbledon. It is renowned for the FA Cup. It is renowned for the boat race. It is renowned for the Grand National. And it is renowned for the London Marathon. Every single one of those previous events I've mentioned are 150 years old. The London Marathon celebrated its 40th anniversary, and this is its 40th year. Yeah. And that is quite an incredible thing. And the brand that is built up, and that's the inspiration and what we can do. And I just came, the meeting I was at just prior to this was with a local school. Mm-hmm. And, you know, we have a duty to look after the next generation and do what we can to inspire them. And that is what we're going out into the community to do, to help the community. And I'm delighted to say it was over 111,000 school kids. We've already got more than a third of a million, over 333,000 school kids will be taking part this year. We've got over 1,000 schools taking part, and we've got some really interesting future plans for the mini marathon with TCS. I'm not going to announce them here, we will be announcing them in 2022. And inspiring. I have an 8-year-old daughter, an 11-year-old daughter, and just getting them involved in sport is so important. And do it at a young age, just get them to have fun, right? We've got to make it fun. And that's what the marathon, it sounds one of the oddest things that actually, you know, running 26.2, running is fairly boring. It's one foot in front of another. Yet the number one word to describe the London Marathon, number one word to describe running is boring, yet the number one word to describe the London Marathon is fun. And that's the people, the community, your fellow runners, the conversations, that it opens new horizons for you. So I just hope that anyone that is thinking, any one of your listeners that's thinking about, oh, I can't do it, or I can't take that first step, yes, you can. You absolutely can. And as painful as it is, and as difficult it is for the first 6 weeks, that first 6 or 7 weeks is the hardest. After that, the endorphins kick in, a natural high. And you therefore want to go for a run because you want to get that natural high. And you might be going in the first week, that's never going to happen. It does, I promise you. And if you can do it, go out there one step at a time. You don't have to just run, walk, do what you can, have some fun with it, inspire your neighbor, inspire your family, do it together. And I just hope that that really resonates with people listening.
No, it does indeed. And you're right. We as runners, we are known as the breed, possibly that is crazy. Most of the times by other people, they'll be like, who are these guys who are sleeping this early, waking up this early, training for months after month? And then after their hard workout sessions and marathons, they're limping. But the high that it gives, it's at another level. And like you said, once you are able to go past that 6 weeks period, that's when the fun starts. And that's when you join the wagon of these crazy people, this the breed of people who are going to be in it. I remember as soon as lockdown started to open, I didn't have a place at London Marathon, and there was entry restrictions. And at the same time, I got entry to Berlin, got my tickets booked and everything. And people are like, hey, you're traveling. I'm like, yeah, I need to go and do the marathon because it's been 18 months of no runs and life doesn't seem simple. Now to the point of the beginner runners, we know how popular a marathon is, that is any marathon, and we know how popular London Marathon is, which has become the epitome of the marathon racing in the world. But there are a number of people who are upcoming, who are starting to possibly know about a marathon and the London Marathon, possibly from today's conversation. What would be your advice to them about London Marathon, and what should they expect when they come for the very first time? Because the very first marathon, and if it is London, has to be super, super special. What should they know and feel and experience, or they expect to feel and experience as they come?
Yeah, I think you know, doing a marathon for the first time can feel incredibly daunting, and you can get incredibly nervous. And I think if you're doing a big marathon, as in one with a lot of people in, so whether it's the TCS Mumbai Marathon, TCS Amsterdam, New York, Berlin, London, whatever it is, it will be the crowds of people. And I have a few tips for people, which is, if you're going to do a marathon, when you do it, do not do anything new for the first time on that day. No, if the marathon starts at 10 o'clock in the morning, eat probably at 7 o'clock in the morning. So have had your food 3 hours beforehand. And therefore, when you're doing your long runs, practice having your food 3 hours beforehand, and then you do your long run. Practice drinking on the run. Practice the whatever the sponsor in the London Marathon is. Lucozade is our sports drink on the course. So therefore use that Lucozade in your training, because what you want to do, it's really odd. You start the marathon and you drink the Lucozade, and usually you go, oh my God, that's so sweet. That's like, that's just like sugar.
Yeah.
And you go, that's too sweet. I can tell you, by the time you get to mile 20, you just want more and more of it, because you just crave that sugar. And it's just an interesting thing of what your body is going through. You are depleting your sugar levels, your glycogen levels. So practice whatever you're going to do on the day. Do not then, do not get too worried. Don't think, oh, I've got to do something called carbo loading. Right. If you're going to carbo load, which is you starve yourself for carbohydrates for a few days beforehand, and then the last day just before you eat loads of them, don't ever do that for the first time just before you're going to run a marathon again. If you're going to do that, practice that in your long runs beforehand. But I think it's just be rested. Also try and get there. The training is hard, right? It's not easy. And so calm it down in those last 2 weeks. Nothing you do in those last 2 weeks is going to make it better. Anything's just going to make it worse. So try and get some rest. Stay well hydrated. Do what you would normally do the night before. I say to people, if you normally go to bed and you have a beer or a wine, have a beer or a wine. Just don't have lots of them. Keep it at one.
Don't be in the pub, possibly, the previous night.
If you can be in the pub, but just have one. Don't have lots. So I think it's just about relaxing. It's you will be nervous, you will be apprehensive. But what can you control? Going back to the first thing, you can control how well rested you are, how well hydrated you are, what you've eaten beforehand, and whether you are relaxed or not. You can control those things, because if you've practiced them beforehand, you've done them beforehand, it takes away so much of the anxiety about doing something first, because you've done all those things. You know what the sports drink is. You had it before. So that's how we remove anxiety. Practice it. And that would be my tip to anyone running their first marathon. And the last one is, don't worry about the start. It will be crowded. Don't think if you're behind those first 2 miles, you then have to go really, really quick to catch up the speed. No, you don't. The marathon doesn't start until mile 20. Those last 10Ks when it starts. Halfway is not halfway. It might be in distance, but it's not physically. So relax, chill out, have a smile, and practice what you're going to do on the day.
Awesome. This mile 20 point is so, so important for people to keep in mind. And people will not know it unless they have gone through their first marathon. So thank you very much for that. I have a question from one of the listeners that is about good for age entry for international runners. We know that a number of other races, world majors, have good for age entry for overseas candidates. However, it's not the case for London. Do you have any plans in future that it will be coming up, opening up for them as well?
Yeah, so we don't. However, what we do have is the Abbott World Marathon Majors Wanda Age Group World Championships that are taking place in this year's London Marathon. And so actually we will have some of the best runners in the world coming to the London Marathon, age group runners from 40 upwards coming to the London Marathon. And one of the, you know, in terms of all your listeners might go, well, why are you not opening up good for age for international? One of the founding aims of the London Marathon was to improve the standard of British marathon running. And so we have slightly changed it. It's to improve the standard of British endurance running. And so we have a responsibility to try and help British people to get on the journey of marathon running. It is incredibly difficult. We had 454,000 people apply for the 2019 event. We are the most popular marathon on the planet. And we can't please everybody. And it gets very, very difficult to say, well, actually, if we open up good for age for international runners, we're going to have to reduce the number of good for age for British runners. So getting this balance right, we've been upping the number of international entries we take each year. So, you know, to be more global. And again, that's why we talked about 2022 and the date moving to the 2nd of October from our April date, which will go back in 23 to an April date. But that's the rationale behind what we do at the moment.
Makes a lot of sense. Thanks for that. Towards the end now, 3rd October is the D-Day this year, and London Marathon is fast approaching. For the people who are going to be doing a London Marathon this year, what, in your opinion, what do you think they should expect that will be slightly different with the ongoing situation? And what is also your message to them?
So my first message is come, enjoy, have a smile on your face. It's going to be an amazing day, an incredible day. I think genuinely it could be the most emotional London Marathon that there's ever been. I think that we're coming out of having just had the Tokyo 2020 Olympics, and certainly when the athletes were being interviewed on TV, the emotion that they were showing because the Olympics had happened, because of all the uncertainty, was it going to happen? Was it not going to happen? And even though they didn't have crowds, they were able to perform and they were able to have this amazing experience. And I think the emotion that they showed, I think this is going to be the Olympics for the mass. I think that that emotion that Olympic athletes shown will be the emotion that the everyday runner is going to show on the 3rd of October. So what are we doing that is changing? Everyone has to take a lateral flow test. If you're coming from abroad, a PCR test will also work because you've probably taken that through the flight into the country. So everyone has to have taken a lateral flow test. We're checking that. What we're doing is the baggage system is different. So you drop your bags off when you pick your number, and that bag is then transported to the finish. So those bags are being packed earlier. So we're doing this so we can collectively reduce. We have a very small finish line. I mean, it's a hugely impressive one, finishing in front of Buckingham Palace on the Mall. But actually, of all the Abbott World Marathon majors, it's the tightest. You know, if you go to New York and you do the TCS New York Marathon, they've got baggage lorries nearly a mile further down Central Park. Ours are an incredibly short space of about about 400 meters. So we've reduced the infrastructure. We don't have 34 lorries moving from the start to the finish. Those crates will be moving over days to the finish. So the baggage is different. We're asking people to wear bottle belts so that it reduces, it's more sustainable. And again, sustainability is such an important thing for the world. If we look at natural disasters that are going on, whether, you know, the difficulties that we're having, whether it's flooding, whether it's fire, with the world warming up, these extreme weather conditions. So there are things that we're asking runners to do for the first time. The start will be going off over an hour and a half period. It's normally over about a 50-minute period, but actually, they might sound like big steps. I actually think on the day, I really hope they will feel quite normal and people will feel safer as a result of the steps that we've taken.
True. And I think that's in the benefit of everybody who's participating and everybody who's around there. I think that makes absolute sense. Just one small question on the lateral flow and PCR test. Is it in addition to the fully vaccinated individuals, like they need to be vaccinated and then the test as well, right?
No, the vaccination is irrelevant.
Okay.
So the UK government just announced that in England, it was not bringing in vaccination passports. Okay. So it is only that you need to show that you currently, that you've been tested on a lateral flow test, either the day that you've come to pick your number up or the day before. In the case of a PCR test, you get another day on top of that. There'll be details going out. Not sure when this broadcast is going out, but there are details going out, further details going out to all the runners. And we're trying to keep it quite simple with some ticked boxes and just been looking at that in the last 24 hours. So it is purely that you've taken the test. So that ensures that people on the start line, as much as we can through the testing process, are not there with COVID.
Awesome. Hugh, this has been a fantastic conversation. Here in India, we are growing in numbers in terms of runners every week, every month. We've seen during the COVID time as well, indoor sport, even though it was indoor, people picked up walking and running even within the house. And later we can see it on the roads and in the parks, people are taking endurance sport as a way of getting fitter. And we're learning the ropes through science and technology, as we talked about. Do you have any other message in addition to what we discussed for the beginner runners here in India specifically?
I think the only other thing would be find someone to do it with. I think if you find a colleague, you find a family member, you find a neighbor, and they will inspire you on the difficult days, and hopefully you'll inspire them on the difficult days. So if you can get a group, get together with a group of you, and it's just that early stage that's the most difficult. And the more you have people supporting you, the better it is. If you are lucky enough to be able to get massage, a sports massage, you know, and you're a beginner, your muscles are gonna be working for the first time, they might be a bit stiffer. And if you're lucky enough to be able to do that, that would be something else. But I just above all, take it one step at a time. If you're feeling very tired, don't do it that day, do it another day. Do it with a smile, do it with fun, but get a group of you together, because it's that motivation that you provide, and that's the community. You'll be then part of that community and they'll inspire you on those harder days.
Awesome. Thank you so much, Hugh. This has been such a great conversation. Thank you for everything. Thank you for inspiring all our listeners. And good luck with the London Marathon, and it will be legendary as always. And we look forward to speaking soon again.
Yeah, look, thank you so much. Look forward to welcoming as many of your countrymen as possible to the UK and to the TCS London Marathon from 22 and onwards. And it's going to be a great partnership, and just the relationship, I hope, between India and the UK will just blossom and flourish. And this is another way of showing it.
Yeah, super excited. Thank you so much, Hugh.
Thank you. Bye-bye.
This was all for today. Hopefully you enjoyed it and you are as inspired as I am. I'm ready and I'm excited to go and get my run. I need to get to Berlin soon, and I hope that you are getting out for your training run or racing, whichever is coming your way. Good luck and speak to you soon.